Okay, I want to introduce to the plenary speaker Yolanda Isela from Institución Milà en Fontanals, CSIC, Barcelona. Yolanda.
Okay, thank you so much. Well, first of all, I would like to thank the invitation to be here today. We are so proud to the work that you have done, you especially, but also Araceli González Vázquez, because both has worked a lot to organize this conference. Is it okay? Yeah. And then I'm also happy because it's an opportunity to find ourselves, to enjoy and to share our researchers that we are developing nowadays. Well, I'm going to talk about a research project that we have in Barcelona, in the Spanish Council for Scientific Research. It is a project that the main object was to compare the Spanish colonialism in Africa, especially in Morocco and in Equatorial Guinea. Then we have a team that is partially are dedicated to the study of Equatorial Guinea, and the other part are studying the Moroccan country. Then in my case, nowadays I'm preparing two different, well, in fact, three texts. One is about the transnational kinship of Equatorial Guinea people, that is so different. Another that is a comparison between the Spanish colonialism in Africa, in the case of Equatorial Guinea and Morocco, in the scientific discourse, also in the politics of the indigenous people, also about the administration of the colony, etc., to see really the differences that the Spanish colonialism developed in two different countries of Africa, with different views from Occident, of these people, of African people and North Africa. And the last one, text that I'm preparing now, that is on, I mean, is I'm working on, is about, is what I'm going to talk now. In fact, this subject, the idea, the initial idea was to try to see if the Spanish colonialism in the Spanish protectorate really developed the same politics that developed the French colonialism about divide et impera, talking about Arab and Berber people. I thought that it was important to research this question because it is true that the postcolonial Moroccan history and the politics has been also developed in a way, in a very special way, about how, which were the problems that appeared during the colonial period about these two ethnic groups of Morocco. And in fact, when the Morocco arrived to the independence, we can see different ways that the Arabism, also linked to Islam, has been the main subject of the construction, the building of the national state. In part, it is also explained because the politics of the French protectorate benefited to the Arabic people, I'm sorry, to the Berber people in front of the Arabic one. But this, I think it's interesting to do this research that is a big team. Well, we are seven persons working on. I think it's interesting because if we pay attention of the Spanish protectorate, really it was necessary to prove if the Spanish people, the Spanish colonialism, also practiced these politics of divide et impera between Arab and Berber. And when we study with different the different material document that we can read, we can see that this didn't happen in the Spanish protectorate. Then this is the main idea that I want to present, also because the final question if it's necessary to rethink the contemporary Moroccan history, the post-colonial one until nowadays, in relation to how both ethnic groups have collaborated with the construction of the national state, and in the same level, okay? Well, then I have presented in general. There are three main questions that I want to talk about. The first is to see if the Berber require a big effort to claim their specificities in the Moroccan state, because as we will see, in fact, they have participated in the colonial fight during the to obtain the independence. I mean that they have an important role in this question. The second question that is an object of the research is if it's important their effort, because must still be greater in order to rewrite this role that I explained to the contemporary history of Morocco. And the third one is the way to review the influence of Berber in Morocco in the research of the Spanish protectorate. That is main, more or less what I present. I have to say that this project has the advantage that the last 15 years we have, for example, Josep Lluís Mateo, that he's an anthropologist, that has done research about this question. It was partially his PhD about the Moroccan protectorate, the Spanish protectorate. Also other people, that as Manuela Marín, that she's from the Arabism, from the CSIC, the Spanish Council of Scientific Research. And also other historians, as Eloy Martín, or Víctor Morales Lezcano, that he's from other research, other discipline. But the idea is to try to recuperate all this work that has been done, also in Morocco, in Massous, that we have very interesting works done by Moroccan people, that I cannot understand why they have not the merit to have more recognition in Europe, and I cannot understand why they haven't. I think that this has to be solved. And I want also to say that we are doing the research also in the general archive of the administration that we have from Spain, the documentation that is in Alcalá de Henares. For example, last week I was in Alcalá de Henares and I found a box with a lot of expedients, of the biographical expedients of the Moroccan people that were qualified as nationalists during the 1931 until the 1936. I mean, there is a lot of documents that need to be studied and that can help us to try to give sense to those that I want to talk about. Well, the main questions that I would like to talk is, the first one is, if are the Berber undervalued and outlying versus the Arab in Morocco? The second is, does Arab subsume the Berber? And also, does Islam homogenize Arab and Berber groups completely? And the third one, can a research be influenced by the Berber's invisibility in general, I mean? Then I will start with the first one about trying to see these differences between Spanish and French protectorates. I need to know the time. How much time I have? 20. Okay, I will go fast. Okay. Well, the first question. important to see the differences between the Spanish and the French protectorate. Basically, because as I said at the beginning, the French protectorate was defined after the pacification of the Spanish protectorate area, that was in 1927, by the maxim divide et impera, a process that has begun with the Dahir Berber of 1930, and that later would be used. I have seen also documentation about this. It's a question that was used by a lot of nationalists in the French protectorate, as for example, in the area of Fès. The city of Fès was especially important in the 1930, 1931, 1932, with the public manifestations in the street trying to fight to prohibit it. The Dahir Berber. I mean, there is a lot of Moroccan population in the urban. This is another question that we have no. We will have no time, but it's interesting how the fight against the colonial imperialism of the French and the Spanish has changed first from the rural until the 20s, end of 20s, and later has started in the urban area during the 30s on. There is a change, no? That also is related to all the session that has explained the Professor Rashik about this ideologization, no? of Islam. Well, this is also to debate later. Well, the Dahir Berber allowed the application of the Berber legislation in the French colony, while the colonial structures would difficult the implementation of the Islamic law. Minimum in theory was like this. In fact, in the Spanish protectorate, things would be so different because we had the persons that applied the law. Interventores, I don't know if in English is interventor, no? That at the end usually decide locally how to solve the problems, the conflicts in their area. Well, the division between Arabs and Berbers promoted by the French colonial structures postponed de facto the fight together of the Moroccan people seeking independence. And this was especially important in the French protectorate. The differences between Arab and Berbers was also supported by a large part of the Anglo-European researchers, David Montgomery Hart, Ernest Gellner, Jacques Berg, Clifford Geertz, also his wife Hildred Geertz, Lawrence Rosen, James Waterbury, Dale Eichelman, Kenneth Brown, Raymond Jaumous. I mean, there is a lot of different, very important anthropologists that from the 30s, I'm thinking, for example, the work of Carlenton Kuhn, that is the first one that talking about tribes in Rif, that is a work of 1930, until the end of the 60s, and including the 70s, that we have works also that still talk about or are continuing the work of David Montgomery Hart and this view of his view of the tribe. Then what I want to mean is that the difference that has been built about Arab and Berber people is so very well founded in the basis of the Moroccan identity done by anthropologists, by this European and Anglo-American anthropologist. Then differences between Arab and Berbers usually were a question of language, but I will go very fast with these different images that I have put, the question of the language. Also the differences about the Islamic law versus the customary law. This is a very obvious difference. I mean, it has not very question of discussion. Maybe we can discussion the influence in the customary law, the Amasic one, of Islamic Islamic jurisprudence or Islamic law, but in general, it is true that are so different. Also, another question so repeated was the difference between Vila da Silva, Vila d'Almacén. In the case of the Spanish Protectorate, there are so little works talking about that. In fact, for example, it seems that there were tribes in the Spanish Protectorate that was not Vila da Silva because they pay taxes to the Maxen. I mean, is also something that that existed, but also so invited, no, or repeated, trying to create a general way to see, again, the difference between groups. Well, and also there are other differences between Arab and Berbers, the differences between brackets, because there are questions to discussion, no? For example, in the practicing in Islam, think that that exists an official Islam that is the most important is the mosque, the Quran, etc., etc. Also, in comparison with, and also was Arabic, obviously, no? And another way to practice the Islam that is in the Muslim, is the Morabit, and is another center that is not exactly the official Islam, no? That was, obviously, this was thought especially to the Berber people. That later there were studies that has outlined how this popular Islam is also present in the city. I mean, in the village. Well, I'm mixing now French and English. But anyway, the difference it was not obvious. Also, we have anthropologists that has defended the differences between kinship from the Arabic people or Berber. But in fact, there are not many differences because both are patrilineal, both are patrilocal. It's true that the preferential endogamy, this kind of marriage, was especially practiced by the Rifian people. It's not something, a practice that we can find in other Berber people of other areas, it's especially in the Rif. But it's true that this preferential endogamy that is the preferred by the Arabic people, not the more practiced, we can share with some groups of Berber people. The extended family is something that is common in Arabic and Berber. I mean, there is no difference. And the polygynous marriage is true that was more practiced by the Arabic people at the beginning, but nowadays, and with a lot of Berber people living in cities, I mean, all of this has changed a lot, no? Although it's true that was something so repeated. Also, another question that was studied by this anthropologist that I have quoted was the urban versus the rural context, thinking that the urban context was basically a context where the Arabic people were living, while the Berber people, the Amazigh, were living in the rural context. This is also something that during the decade, with the pass of the decades, has been seen that nowadays it is impossible to be very, very clear to show these differences in the context of these groups, no? I'm sorry. Then, when we try to create a lot of differences between groups, sometimes this has an effect that is that we hide the exchange and conferences in different aspects. For example, in the kinship, because between Arabic and Berber people there were intermarriage, because it was practiced, also the invented genealogies, that is something also presented. In question, for example, in question of religion, the participation of the Arabs in the Muslim, or the attendance of Berbers to mosques, that this creation of the anthropology about the Moroccan differences between groups has examples really a little bit difficult to maintain. And also, for example, in the question of the law, the use of the fiqh among the Berbers. And for example, we have in the Spanish Protectorate, we have a work done by an interventor, no, this person that was applying the law in the area, that has recuperated different laws, customary law of Berber people, also looking if there were or not influence of the fiqh of the Islamic right. Islamic law. Also, it's important when we talked about this Berber undervalued and outlying versus the Arab in Morocco, thinking in the question of the population, because although the country is shared by Arabs and Berbers, it depends on which is the source. We can find there are people that talk about the 65% are Arabic people, but others say that it's not the 65, it's the 40. I mean, it seems that what is the majority of these the ethnic groups in Morocco, which is the Arabic, is the Berber people. I mean, it's something that is important to put it in clear, no? And also because, as I said in the beginning, the national state in the post-colonial period was built over Arab identity and not the Berbers one. And this is something that we can see perfectly in the constitution, that it seems that would be changed. Then, one thing that then has to be thought about if is Islam and Arabism subsume the Amazigh, and if it has this fact has different consequences in Morocco and in transnational migration. When the transnational migration, I will not going to develop, but in the case of Morocco, I think it's interesting first that the Moroccan constitution granted the influence of the Islam and religious practices in the legal dimension, but thinking related to the Arab, I am sure that there are different questions that allow to do this like this, okay? Because the Islam, the born in the Arabic country, in La Mecca, there are a lot of reasons because there is this relation between Islam and Arab. Is evident, no? But anyway, this is something that is very clear also in the Moroccan constitution. A second question is that the Berbers were not very visible despite sharing faith and literacy in madrasa. For example, in the Spanish Protectorate, and this, for example, is true that is very well explained by David Montgomery Hart, that in the case of the White Warriagar, the Beni Urriagel, the people had their own madrasas and masjid, las mosques, no, to go to the prayer. But at the end, we can have the final sensation that the Berbers in Morocco were less Muslims, all with brackets, no, than the Arabs, because they introduced some flexibility in Islamic religious practices and in Islamic law. That this is something that it seems that nobody wants to say very well. That is something that is so inside in the mind, okay? But it's something that it's difficult that people express openly. But it's something that we can find hided in about this practice of the Berber people of Islam. Then, continuing thinking in this questions, it has been only in very recent time, more than a decade, that the Moroccan state first has decided the incorporation of the Amazigh language in the school, helped by IRCAM. In fact, IRCAM, the Institut Royal de Culture Amazigh, has done a very, and is doing a very, very hard work trying to make visible the Amazigh in Morocco. And also, it's true that it's in very recent time that have committed a constitutional reform to integrate the Amazigh in the state. That is something that is going on and would be interesting to see how will be really concrete in paper in the constitution finally. Then, if I ask myself if is the Berber undervalued and outlying versus the Arab in Morocco, my sensation is yes, it is, they are. Basically because Berbers require a big effort to claim their own specificities in the Moroccan state. And second, their effort must still be greater in order to rewrite their role in the contemporary history of their country. That is something that need to be done. And how to do this rewrite of the contemporary history of Morocco? I propose, for example, do it by the story of how the things were in the Spanish protectorate. Basically because we can find things that allow us to demonstrate this fight of Amazigh people for the construction of the, well, to arrive to the independence of Morocco and also to try to construct their own country. Using this Spanish protectorate case, we can see first that in the former Spanish protectorate, Amazigh promoted teaching Arabic and the Muslim religion since the 1930, as evidenced by the biographies of Abdel Khaled Torres or Abdel Karim al-Khattabi in different ways. In fact, they neither rejected the Arab Islamic culture. I think that this probably is more interesting in the Abdel Karim case because he founded the Republic of Amazigh, okay, in northern of Morocco. But is so interesting as a personage, his biography, the relations of his parents, of his father, with the Spanish administration, and the way he connects with the Arab League, trying to find supporters in other Arabic countries to his desire of being independent from the European colonialism. I think is interesting, but also is very interesting Abdel Khaled Torres. For example, there is an historian so known in Spain that is Maria Rosa de Madariaga. She's very, very nice. And Maria Rosa de Madariaga, she's an historian that knows a lot about Abdel Khaled Torres. She knows a lot, but she didn't decide, or she didn't find the moment to write the definitive book about Abdel Khaled Torres. I think that probably she has problems to write this book about this man because he's so difficult to do the approach because his way to do the things, his relationships with Alal al-Fasi in the French protectorate, with the Spanish colonizers, etc., no? Present a person with a lot of matices, I don't know how to, with a lot of shadows, lights and shadows, I want to mean. Well, in fact, thinking about these people, Abdel Khaled Torres, Abdel Karim al-Khattabi, but other people a lot also, their demands often renounced to a Berber identity affirmation, especially Abdel Khaled Torres, because the objective was to the Moroccan liberation from European colonialism. And then I think that could be, especially Torres could be used to, as a person to connect to the French colonialism and to can be used to connect the Moroccan history between Arabs and Berbers. This is what I want to mean. Also, in the Spanish Protectorate, the Berbers encouraged the implementation of Moroccan nationalism before Arabs in the French Protectorate. For example, in the documents that I'm consulting, I found meetings of Abdelkhaled Torres with Alal al-Fassi before the nationalism in the French Protectorate could be consolidated. For example, I'm talking about Torres because I don't want to give a lot of names, but in the Spanish Protectorate and also in the French one, we have Benuna, Daud, Belafrère. There are not only Alal al-Fassi that is the most important one and the symbol. And all of these people were connecting and had a lot of meetings. For example, there was a person that is Chakrib Arsalam. Chakrib Arsalam was a very influential nationalist, but defender also of Islam. He were living in Belgium in the 30s, and he paid part of the travels of these nationalist people to Europe. And for example, if we look the documents of the Spanish Protectorate, of the Oficina Mixta de Información, that was as the secret police, no, of the Spanish colonialism, of Chakrib Arsalam, they have like this, the expedient, the documents, no? Because it was a person that worried a lot, but he helped a lot also to Alal al-Fassi. I mean, Alal al-Fassi, I would like to say is that Alal al-Fassi didn't arrive alone to the nationalist movement and to the independence of Morocco. There were a lot of people, not only in the French Protectorate, but also in the Spanish one in the 30s, helping to consolidate this group. And part of them were Berber. This is only what I want to synthesize. This is the idea, no? It's true that they were who could organize in Morocco in the Spanish Protectorate, the first nationalist political party, this one of Abdelkhaled Torres, also helped by Benuna. There were other people in this one, and later would appear in others. Also, the first Arabic language newspaper, but there were Asalam, there were different newspapers. There is a first one, but later would appear other ones. Obviously, first in the Spanish Protectorate. And also, as was happening the same in Fes, in Tetuán, for example, there were street demonstrations claiming nationalism. The third question, I have to finish, is that in the Spanish Protectorate, Berbers as Abdelkrim, Torres or others internationalized the need to finish with the European colonial systems in conferences and activities in Cairo, actions that allowed them to obtain the support of the Arab League. It's impossible for me to study everything. I will not develop this in my studies, but it's true that we have documentation about these connections in the international arena with other countries helping the French nationalism. And also I would like to mention that each current vindicative movement, based on their identity and their linguistic specificities, counterbalanced the post-colonial Amazigh invisibility. Therefore, it seems that never existed the brief historical complicity of Berber with Arab nationalists as Moroccans, this is the national identity I want to mean, emerged in the 1930s. During the 30s, Also, sometimes seems that Amazigh haven't do nothing to fight against colonizers or to defend Arab Muslim culture, but in fact, it is not exactly true. I'm sorry. Then, could our researchers be influenced by the Berber invisibility when we analyze the contemporary history of Morocco? Well, I think yes, if we do not contrast the results with historical and biographical data, and I think that another time the Spanish Protectorate can give us some documentation that can allow us to be more cautious, no, with some asseverations. Then as conclusions, and with this I will finish, the first one is that the colonial theoretical fictions of Berber otherness would condition its study if we do not take analytic precautions. And the second is that the current Amazigh protest movement in Morocco seems that is constructed as contrary to Arab, something that did not happen in the Spanish Protectorate when was a movement against colonization as Moroccans that emphasized the national identity, not the ethnic one. And with this I will finish. I'm sorry I tried to do it so clear, but sometimes it's not easy. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Yolanda. Any questions?
Okay, thank you. So I will present myself as I'm Josep Lluís Mateo from the Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona. And thank you very much, Yolanda, for this interesting topic and this historical research based on this labyrinth of archives, because I know these archives and this is a very difficult work. And it's very important to open these cartons and to see what the documents say. And I just wanted to remark to two things. One is the paradox about Abdelkrim, because Abdelkrim founded the Jumhuria Rifia, the Rifa Republic, but it was not a Berber Republic. I have discussed many times with Berber friends in Melilla and Ador about this question. Mm-hmm. You can imagine Abdelkrim is the hero of the Berber identity in the Eastern Rif, on the Rif, and he was the one who destroyed the Berber customs, which were there for centuries, like the cut of hair and customary law, because of instrumental political reasons, to unify the tribes and to substitute this customary law for the Islamic mm-hmm. law. Abdelkrim was a reformist. He was he studied at the Fez, and he introduced this reformist ideology. Mm-hmm. And well, it's just just to put this and because this is a very interesting debate about and the figure of Abdelkrim then afterwards when he went to Egypt. And I think this is still a question not well debated in Morocco. Mm-hmm. And some people say that it is perhaps because of the a kind of fight between the bourgeoisie of Tetuan, like Torres and these ones, versus Abdelkrim, who was sometimes seen as a savage of the river. Well, and the second one was just an idea that I like very much, as this the a word used by Jacques Berg in his book on the Sexawa. He uses this concepts of le tissu continu to speak about the intermingling, this relationship between the Arab and the Berber in the history of Morocco, because you know that how in history genealogies has been falsified and how the prestige of being a Sharif, and well, saying that you are Arab and perhaps you have Berber origins, or if these dialectics, I think this is a very interesting question, and just to remember this this proposal of Berg of tissue continue, this dialectics of these two entities. And the last one is you didn't mention Blanco Izaga was the I think it's the exception, the only one who tried to put to copy the Spanish the French policy in the Spanish region, and he even built a building, the office of the office of the Interventor, and this office was an imitation of the Qusur, the these castles of the south. So, but I think it's a very interesting picture to see. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Well, reply. Yeah. Joseph Lluís, as I said before, Joseph Lluís Mateo is one of the anthropologists that has studied this period and this area, and this is because his comments are so clever because he knows a lot all the debate and the things that are unclear until today, no? With Abdel Krim, I have the same sensation, and this is because as it's true that from Abdel Krim we have different biographies, and also Maria Rosa de Madariaga has worked a lot about him, then I'm agree with you that this part linked to the Berber identity that is not developed enough, but that Abdel Krim is used by Berber people in another way that really was not what he did in his time, no? And this is because I think that he obtained this international support of other Arabic countries, because he never talked about Berber, he was talking about Arab and Muslim. And this is so exciting, and I think that has to be studied more, but I cannot, I have no new data. And also what is true about Blanco Izaga, this is because I haven't talked about no interventor in special, because as there were a part, the most part were military, they have their own interests, although that they have an interesting production, a part of them. And this is because I didn't talk especially of nobody. It's true that I have a temptation that is Tomás García Figueras. You know why? Because last week, during my research, my researching time, I found also documents signed by him of the Oficina Mixta de Información, that this was this service, this secret service of the Spanish people in the protectorate, saying things not very nice about what to do with these nationalist people, no? Although that we can read his books about Moroccan history and all of these things, no? This is because I didn't talk especially about nobody, but I think it's something that need to be done. And we can continue later debating.
Hassan, Rashi.
Yes, thank you. Well, thank you, Yolanda, for this rich presentation. And there are, as my colleague said, there are many, many cordas a tirar. So I have two remarks. The first one is related to who decides who is Berber and who is not, and who is Arab and who is not, and what is the role of the anthropologist in defining people as Berber or as Islamic or as Arab or Farsi. And this is a crucial notion, because I feel that there is an authority of anthropologists, I'm not speaking of you, to say you're Berber, no matter what you are saying, you're Berber. I decide that you're Berber and decide that you're Arab. And I guess this let's say, objective definition of a collective identity short its limits. Because if someone who is speaking Berber, whose parents are Berber, said, I'm Arabic, so I'm Islamist, how could you deal with him? Muhammad al-Jabri, a greater philosopher, he was Berber, but he was never claiming his Berber, he was claiming his Arabity. And this is an individual example, but we can find collective examples. Many Islamists are Berbers, many Arabs are Berbers, etc. The other thing is, if we speak about history, the Islamization, the Arabization, according to many historians, I'm not, you know, I have no skills about that, according to many historians, were done by Berbers themselves. Berbers introduced Arabic, introduced Islam, and how to split this? There are no Arabs that Arabized Berbers, and you can find this binary opposition by Arabs, as you presented, by Arabs and Berbers, customary law, Islamic law, within Berber communities. Some doctors, Berber doctors, who defend Islamic law, and Berbers, autochthons, indigenous, you call it whatever, whatever you may call it, defends Islamic law. So this kind of binary, I guess, the binary opposition are very, very slippery. And maybe we should look about complex processes which are, let's say, more useful for the researcher than this binary, which hides many processes. Okay, so I have many scruples because I took an hour this morning, so
it's okay. Okay, thank you so much. I can say that I'm completely agree in both comments. The first one, who decide who is Arab and who is Berber? This is something that has been worked during the colonialism and after the colonialism of the anthropologists for a long time. Maybe is this actual so deeper differentiation done during these 40 or 50 years that provoke that nowadays there are a strong vindication of a group of Berber people, Amazigh people, claiming to be more visibility, their language, their culture, putting at the same level of the Arabic people. This is because today, for a moment that we have talked, I was trying to explain how the anthropology has influenced, I think, not completely, but has a part, okay, of this post-colonial construction of Morocco. And you know that, for example, the way that the social scientists have to analyze identities, the national one, also the ethnic ones, etc., is talking about people and knowing which is the description that they give of themselves. Because at the end, is the people who want to claim something or not. They could be, they can choose to be Moroccan, only Moroccan, or they could need other items to be defined as a person in Morocco, as a citizen. Then, for me also it's very risky that anthropologists do this work alone or take this responsibility, because it's a dangerous thing. Also, for example, it's interesting for me because in the Spanish Protectorate, at the same time, and this connected with your question, that the people that they were that was objective of the colonizers as nationalists, didn't they explain themselves if they were Arabic or Berber? Also, the Spanish colonialists didn't do the differences. When I found this documentation, in no moment I can read is Arabic or is Amazigh. Then this is because I'm completely agree in this comment. About the binary, then I also think that the binary is not is so simplistic to analyze the reality. And I also agree that it's need to include other items in the research. But another time, we need to know what people say. And this is because as the fish, no, moving itself, and we have to try to explain what is happening or what is going on. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Mi las cuestión, Tarik Sabri.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I just want to reemphasize what Professor Rashid...
Your name?
Tarik Sabri from the University of Westminster,
okay,
London.
Okay, thank you.
I just want to reemphasize this kind of binary problem, and I'm glad you acknowledge that it is actually not a helpful binary. It's actually a kind of a hyper distinction that you make between Arab and Berber. It is hyper because of a more serious problematic between two types of discourses. You have the Berberist discourse, mm-hmm. and then you have the anthropologist discourse, and you would expect mm-hmm. the anthropologist discourse or historian's discourse to be distanced mm-hmm. or to have an element of distance, which is very, very important. Mm-hmm. But more importantly for me is that the reason I call this a hyper distinction is because it camouflages mm-hmm. the material realities of Moroccans in general, Arab mm-hmm. or Berber, mm-hmm. yeah, mm-hmm. and their marginalization. It's not just the Berbers who are marginalized, mm-hmm. it also Moroccans of Arab origin and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, in terms of popular discourse, mm-hmm. even within popular discourse, it is well known and established that the Amazighs had a huge and influential kind of role in resistance against the French and so on. So this is not as such. Yeah. But they were there. So, but definitely the distinction is a hyper one. It camouflages other dynamics that are far more important.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you so much. Well, in fact, you're continuing the debate and. I'm agreeing the general comment, and I would like also to say that the production of the anthropologist European and Anglo-American in Morocco is very large, and sometimes it's not so clear what they want to mean to be Berber and to be Arabic, no? And probably I haven't mentioned this more in the presentation, but as was 30 minutes, trying to do it very fast.
Thank you. We go. Is the time? It's a short question. You go. You can take the microphone.
I think. It must be the Amazigh or Berber identity movement, many movements. If it's not the anthropologist who reclaimed their rights, it's them who are Berber themselves. Tell me about their movement, identity movement.
You mean nowadays?
Nowadays.
Yeah, okay. I have to say that my fieldwork about the, because as I explained, I'm doing different things at the same time, and now, as this is what I presented is I'm working on, I can give you references of other researchers, but not my fieldwork, okay, about this revival or this AMASIC defense nowadays in their culture, although that there are researchers that are working on. Then anyway, it's true that the AMASIC movement seems more clear and more strong in Algeria area because it has a more large vindication in time in comparison of Morocco. And also in Morocco, in the case of the defense of the AMASIC identity, it's true that in the case of Morocco has also the help of transnational migrations living in Europe, for example. And then this has need to be studied. I didn't develop it, but it's something to study more.
You. I go to for the lunch now, and we go.